Hello viewers, today let us discuss about Zeeman effect and its quantum mechanical explanation. The outlines of this talk would be that what is spectrum and its types, what is polarization of light and its analysis, effect of magnetic field upon a light source, and what is resolving power. Then we will introduce the topic Zeeman effect, types of Zeeman effect, experimental demonstration of normal Zeeman effect, Lama precession, and then finally we will discuss quantum mechanical explanation of Zeeman effect. The objective of today's talk is to facilitate you to learn about Zeeman effect, its types, and its experimental demonstration, also quantum mechanical explanation of Zeeman effect. The learning outcomes will be that you will be able to discuss the background under which Zeeman effect was discovered. You will understand what is line spectrum. You will be able to describe the experimental setup used by Zeeman, and you will state the conditions at which normal longitudinal and transverse Zeeman effects take place. Also, you will analyze the spectral lines obtained. Zeeman effect. Before discussing Zeeman effect, we should discuss about another eminent scientist, Faraday. Actually, Zeeman derived this thought for this experiment from Faraday's experiment. All of us know who is Faraday, and Faraday became very passionate to know about the impact of magnetic field on the spectrum of a light source. So he did the experiment. He kept a light source in a magnetic field and studied the spectrum emitted by the light source. But he could not observe any change in the spectrum due to the introduction of the magnetic field. So he considered that his experiment was a failure, or magnetic field do not have any impact on the spectrum of the light lamp. Later, Zeeman conceived the same idea and did the experiment. He realized that the spectrum showed some remarkable change in the presence of a magnetic field. So Zeeman realized the failure for Faraday's experiment, that the experiment was not a failure, but the instrument used by Faraday did not have high resolution. So he opted for a spectrograph that has high resolving power. All of us know, if the resolving power is very high, it could show very close objects, very, very close objects as two independent objects. So Zeeman was very careful in choosing a spectrometer with high resolving power. And he repeated the same experiment which was done by Faraday. Now, let us see what is Zeeman effect. When a source of light giving line spectrum is placed in magnetic field, the spectral lines are split up into number of component lines symmetrically distributed about the original line is called Zeeman effect. So Zeeman chose a spectrometer with high resolving power. Also, he chose a light source that is giving out line spectrum. A lamp can give the spectrum. The spectrum can have continuous spectrum, line spectrum, and band spectrum. Zeeman did not choose the lamp that was giving a continuous spectrum and band spectrum, because his intention was, when the lamp is placed in a magnetic field, how the spectral lines are impacted. If he chooses a lamp source that is giving out a continuous spectrum or band spectrum, And when you apply the magnetic field, you cannot make out the difference. The continuous band is getting multiplied. The bands are again getting multiplied. It is not easy to distinguish. If you choose a lamp that is giving out a line spectrum, lines are very, very sharp lines. So when the magnetic field is applied, whether the number of lines is increasing or not can be easily studied. So he was careful to choose a lamp source that was giving out a line spectrum so that the spectral study could be very easy. So he chose the lamp and kept it in the magnetic field. Now he observed that in the presence of the magnetic field, each spectral line split up into many component lines symmetrically distributed along the about the original line, which is called Zeeman effect. Now, the types of Zeeman effect. There are two types. Normal Zeeman effect generally takes place in strong magnetic field, and another type is anomalous Zeeman effect that takes place when a weak magnetic field is applied. This normal Zeeman effect also having different types, right? The first one is normal longitudinal Zeeman effect. It is a splitting up of each spectral line into two components in strong magnetic field along the longitudinal view. This is called normal longitudinal Zeeman effect. Another type is that normal transverse Zeeman effect. This is once again splitting up of each spectral line into three components in a strong magnetic field along the transverse view. That is why it is called normal transverse Zeeman effect. Longitudinal Zeeman effect means you have to view the spectrum along the magnetic field. And he observed each line is splitting up into two components. Normal transverse Zeeman effect means you have to view the spectral lines in a direction perpendicular to the flow of magnetic lines of force. So he observed each line split up into three components. Anomalous Zeeman effect is that each spectral line was split up into many lines when a weak magnetic field was applied. In today's class, we will discuss only about normal Zeeman effect. Let us now discuss about the experimental setup. So he chose a light source that was giving out line spectrum. In our lab, we have used sodium vapor lamp. We have used mercury vapor lamp. If you use a grating or a prism, you could observe the spectrum of the mercury vapor lamp or the sodium vapor lamp. When you use a grating or a prism, the spectrum had, suppose if it is a mercury vapor lamp, the spectrum has seven colors called vibgia. If you use a sodium vapor lamp, you will see only two lines. Okay, so that is as like a lamp giving out line spectra. Why he chose a lamp that is giving out line spectrum is spectral study becomes easier. Then we have to apply a magnetic field. For that we need magnets. Zeeman designed the magnets in such a way that he drilled a hole along the length of the magnet. A magnet has north pole and south pole. It's an electromagnet. An iron piece, a long iron piece, is shaped into conical shape so that the flux lines get focused here. And a hole is drilled along this iron piece, on this piece as well as on this piece, so that the light can pass through this opening. Okay, now when you wind a coil on this iron piece and pass electric current, this iron piece becomes a magnet. So you call this magnet as an electromagnet, because this iron piece becomes a magnet in the presence of a current. Otherwise, it's just an iron piece only. And Zeeman used a spectrometer that has high resolving power. So spectrometer in our lab we have used, it has a collimator, it has a telescope. Collimator will be focused at the lamp or the light source, and the telescope attached with the eyepiece, you can move the telescope at any angle. So you move the telescope of the spectrometer or spectrograph and view in this direction, or you move the telescope and take to the side and view the light in this direction. So this direction is parallel to the length of the magnet, or I can say the flux lines are starting from the North Pole and end at the South Pole. So if your viewing angle is along the lines of magnetic lines of force, you call it as a longitudinal mode. So you can turn the telescope and take it to longitudinal view and view the spectral lines. Okay, you can also take the telescope of the spectrograph and keep here and view the light. Now this angle of viewing is perpendicular to the magnetic lines of force. So this mode of viewing is called transverse view. So why he drilled a hole in the magnet? Now you understand, to have a longitudinal view. So Zeeman observed the light, took the light source and kept in the magnetic field. Now he is going to observe the spectral lines in longitudinal view as well as in transverse view. This is the experimental setup. Okay. Next, let us see. When there is no magnetic field was applied, he observed only a single spectral line in the spectrum. No magnetic field was applied. The spectrum showed only a single line. No magnetic field means B equal to zero. Further, he analyzed the spectral line using Nicol prism or tourmaline crystal, and he wanted to know whether any polarization has taken place. So when he tested, when he analyzed with the analyzer, he observed that in the absence of magnetic field, the line, the spectral line, what he got was unpolarized. That means the spectral line contained vibration in all direction. That is what unpolarized. Next, he moved the telescope in a direction perpendicular to the magnetic lines of force. This view is called transverse view. So this is normal Zeeman effect because the magnetic field chosen is very strong. But two different views, one is transverse view, another is longitudinal view. In transverse view, which he observed, that was a remarkable difference. The single line that appeared in the absence of the magnetic field now split up into three lines in transverse view. Then he used a polarizer and an analyzer and wanted to know the nature of polarization of these lines. Now magnetic field, strong magnetic field is there. Now when he analyzed, he observed all the three lines are linearly polarized. Linearly polarized means it contained vibrations only in one plane. And then he wanted to know whether any difference between these two lines and the middle line. He observed that the middle line was linearly polarized in a direction parallel to the applied magnetic field, whereas the other two lines are linearly polarized but perpendicular to the magnetic lines of force. This is what called normal transverse Zeeman effect. In the presence of the magnetic field, the original line splits up into three lines. The outer line symmetrically placed about the original line, and all the three lines are linearly polarized. The original line or the middle line linearly polarized parallel to the applied magnetic field, and the outer lines are linearly polarized in a direction perpendicular to the applied magnetic field. This spacing between the outer line and the midline is called Zeeman shift. And this side also he observed Zeeman shift, and to his surprise, this delta nu remained the same. That means the outer lines are symmetrically placed about the original line. These are the observations he made when he viewed the spectral lines in transverse view. Next, you took the telescope and viewed along the longitudinal view, that is parallel to the magnetic field. Now he wanted to know whether any change was there in the spectrum. He observed a change. What is the change? In longitudinal view, the middle line is missing. He could see only the outer two lines in longitudinal view. And when he analyzed with the analyzer, he observed that both the lines are circularly polarized, one in the anticlockwise direction and the other one in the clockwise direction. So beautiful observation he made. In the absence of the magnetic field, the spectral line he obtained was single only and it was unpolarized. When a strong magnetic field is applied and when the spectrum is viewed in the transverse view, this single line split up into three lines, all the three lines linearly polarized, the midline linearly polarized parallel to the applied magnetic field, and the outer lines polarized in a direction perpendicular. Now he changed the view. He took the spectrometer telescope into longitudinal view. To his surprise, the middle line was missing and the outer two lines were present, and they were circularly polarized, one in the anticlockwise direction and other in the clockwise direction. These are the experimental observations. What Faraday could not observe, Zeeman could observe because his spectrograph had high resolving power. Also, he viewed the spectrum in different perceptions, in different angle of view, so that he could get different observations. Now, Zeeman was successful and he got Nobel Prize. Presence of magnetic field split the spectral lines into many was the new idea. So he got Nobel Prize for this experiment. But he could not give any theoretical explanation for this observations. Quantum theory gave explanation for normal Zeeman effect. So quantum theory, we know light radiations is made up of quanta of light. Each quanta can have a minimum energy and the light source can emit n quanta. So each quanta of energy would be h mu. So light source can emit n quanta of light photons. So this quantum concept, photon can have a minimum energy equal to h mu. That is what quantization. The light photons cannot have continuous energy, or energy of the photon cannot be infinite. It should be discrete only. We need some quantum numbers to locate the position of the electron in an atom. The four quantum numbers which are very essential to locate the position of the electron in an atom is principal quantum number n, orbital angular momentum quantum number l, magnetic orbital angular momentum quantum number ml, and spin quantum number s. If we know these four quantum numbers, easily we can identify where is the electron inside the atom. An eminent scientist by name Debye, without using the spin of the electron, he gave good explanation for normal Zeeman effect. The explanation for normal Zeeman effect was given by Debye without the use of spin of the electron. So only using these three quantum numbers, he beautifully explained the concept of Zeeman effect. Before knowing the quantum explanation of Zeeman effect, we need to know what is called Larmor precession. We know that an electron orbit is equivalent to a magnet, and hence an atom is equivalent to a magnet. So the electron that is revolving in an orbit, the change of position of the electron is equivalent to your current. In magnetism, we know a current carrying loop. The electron orbit is a loop. Current carrying loop behaves like a magnetic field. So the atom behaves like a magnet. Okay? When an atom is placed in an external magnetic field, the electron experiences a torque, because the electron that is revolving around the nucleus itself is behaving like a magnet. Now you are applying another external magnet. There will be interaction between the magnetic field due to the revolving electron as well as the spinning electron and the external magnetic field. As a result, the electron experiences a torque, which causes the orbital angular momentum vector to precess about the direction of the magnetic field B. This precession is known as Larmor precession. The statement is bigger, but with a figure you can easily understand. Now you see, if there is no magnetic field, this electron will be revolving around the nucleus in this orbit. Or if the electron wants to revolve around the nucleus in this orbit, when there is no magnetic field, no problem, this will be going on revolving like this. So when it is revolving in an orbit like this, its orbital angular momentum vector is directed in this direction, because we know orbital angular momentum will always be perpendicular to the plane of the orbit in which electron is revolving around the nucleus. Suppose we consider only this orbit. So when there is no external magnetic field, this electron goes on revolving, and its orbital angular momentum will be directed in this direction. Now when you apply the external magnetic field, a new thing is taking place. Electron is revolving in the orbit. The orbital angular momentum begins to precess about the external magnetic field due to the torque the electron experiencing in the presence of external magnetic field. I hope you understand. The electron is revolving in the orbit, so its orbital angular momentum is directed. In the absence of the magnetic field, this only will be constantly taking place. But the moment you apply the external magnetic field, you observe that the orbital angular momentum begins to precess about the external magnetic field. The angular frequency with which this orbital angular momentum is precessing is known as Larmor frequency, which is noted as omega L, and it is given by Be by 2m naught. So this type of motion is predicted by Larmor. So the angular frequency is named in his honor as Larmor frequency. It is equal to Be by 2m naught. In the presence of the magnetic field only, Larmor precession is taking place. Larmor precession is there means Larmor frequency will be Be by 2m naught. If the external magnetic field is not there, then the electron will be revolving in the orbit only. So that angular frequency is represented as omega naught. Omega zero means magnetic field is zero. So in the absence of the magnetic field, electron is still revolving in the orbit with angular frequency omega naught. So the new angular frequency of the electron in the presence of B, omega naught plus omega L. So when you apply the magnetic field, the angular frequency of the electron becomes omega naught plus Larmor frequency B by 2m naught. Let us now calculate what is the expression for kinetic energy of the electron in the absence of the magnetic field. Kinetic energy of the electron in the absence of the magnetic field given by E naught, which is equal to half m naught V naught square. We know V naught equal to R omega naught. Substitute for V naught as R omega naught, you will be getting the expression E naught equal to half m naught R squared omega naught. So when there is no magnetic field, the electron has energy E naught equal to half m naught R squared omega naught squared. Now when you apply the magnetic field, this omega naught becomes omega naught plus omega L. That's all the concept here. Here m naught is the mass of the electron, v naught is the velocity of the electron, v naught equal to r omega naught. So v naught you have substituted r omega naught, so that the expression becomes half m naught r square omega naught square. Now kinetic energy of the electron in the presence of the magnetic field B, we are going to find out. What we have to do, we have to replace omega naught by omega naught plus omega L. Just see, EB equal to half m naught r square. Now omega naught we have replaced by this expression, omega naught plus B by 2 m naught the whole square. Okay, in the presence of magnetic field, omega naught becomes omega naught plus B by 2 m naught. Let us simplify. Take omega naught outside. So you are getting m naught r square omega naught square. So when you take it outside, this denominator becomes V by 2 m naught omega naught the whole square. Now you apply the formula A plus B the whole square. A square plus 2AB plus B square. So while expanding this part of the formula, we will be ignoring the term B square. So in the next statement, you can see EB equal to half m naught r squared omega naught squared. You know A squared is 1 squared plus 2B by 2 m naught omega naught plus one more term is there that we have ignored. So now we expand EB equal to this into 1 and this into the second term. So now you know EB. You know E naught, that means in the absence of the magnetic field. So we can find out what is the change in the kinetic energy. Change in kinetic energy must be small. So delta E, EB minus E naught. So when you substitute, you find that the first term and the third term getting cancelled. And you are having only the second term. This two cancels. Delta E becomes M naught R squared omega naught, because this omega naught and this omega naught cancel, and we have V by 2 m naught. M naught, this two cancels m naught R squared. This omega naught cancel, so you are having V by 2 m naught. Now we consider two cases. Magnetic field you have applied, and the orientation of the orbit is like this, and electron is moving around like this. So when it is going, the orbital angular momentum will be directed along the magnetic field like this. So your expression becomes the energy for this is like this. Now we know orbital angular momentum. We have from Bohr's atom model, we have understood L equal to m naught v naught r, which is equal to m naught r omega naught into r. We have substituted for v naught. So this is equal to m naught r squared omega naught. So delta E, you can just replace this expression by L. Remember, magnetic field is applied. The orientation of the elliptical path is like this. The orbital angular momentum is parallel to the external magnetic field. So you are having delta E equal to, you have replaced this term by L, B by 2m naught. Here L is along B. But there is another possibility. The electron orbit can be oriented with respect to the external magnetic field. In this case, the orbital angular momentum will make an angle theta with respect to the external magnetic field. So what we have to do? In the previous formula, we wrote delta equal to L B by 2m naught. Now, if the orientation is like this, L should be replaced by L cos theta. Formula remains the same. Because of the inclination of the orientation of the orbit, L is replaced by L cos theta in the previous formula. We know L equal to LH by 2 pi. And L is it in vector atom model. We know that the space should be quantized in magnitude as well as in direction. For quantizing the direction, we apply the external magnetic field and the orbital angular momentum is like this, means you have to take the projection of it along the magnetic field direction. Projection of L along the external magnetic field direction, and that is represented as MLH cross. This is in absence of the magnetic field, we write L equal to LH cross. When you apply the external magnetic field, the magnetic field direction is along Z axis. So you say that L becomes LZ and L should be replaced by MLH cross. This expression is just the same. This is in the absence of magnetic field. This is in the presence of the magnetic field. So LZ equal to ML H cross. H cross equal to H by 2 pi. And LZ is the projection of L along B. Now from this figure, it's a right angle triangle. You can find out what is cos theta. Cos theta is adjacent side by hypotenuse. So LZ by L. We know LZ by L, LZ is MLH cross divided by LH cross. H cross, H cross cancels. You are getting an expression for cos theta. Cos theta equal to ML by L. Therefore, equation 7 becomes delta E. You substitute for L. This is LH by 2 pi. You substitute for cos theta. It is ML by L, B by 2m naught. So rearrange the delta E equal to ML EH by 4 pi m naught B. So delta E is directly proportional to the applied magnetic field. Now here ML is called magnetic orbital quantum number. ML can have 2L plus 1 values. Now, equation 8 shows that an external magnetic field split up a single energy value into 2L plus 1 levels. When the magnetic field is not applied, the spectral line appears single. When you apply the magnetic field splits that single line into 2L plus 1 levels. The amount of splitting is proportional to B. This is called Zeeman effect. Okay. Selection rules. According to selection rules, only those transitions are allowed for which ML changes by 0 or plus or minus 1. So delta E, we know ML into EH by 4 pi m naught into B. This ML can change by 0 or plus or minus 1. Now substitute the values for ML in the energy expression, we find that delta E equal to H delta nu, it could be zero. Energy expression, please remember, ML EH by 4 pi M naught into B. When ML becomes zero, delta E becomes zero. When ML takes up the value of 1, you are getting EH by 4 pi M naught into B. When ML takes the value of minus 1, you are getting delta E becomes minus EH by 4 pi M naught into B. So now, if you want to find out what is delta nu is equal to, just take, divide this by H. So delta nu equal to 0 by H is 0. And this H cancels, you are getting EB by 4 pi M naught. So the presence of the magnetic field makes single line into three lines having frequencies. One is there is no change in frequency, and there is two more lines, one this side, one the other side of the original line. The zero means the original midline in magnetic field, when it is not applied, that original line as such it is coming. The same frequency is retained. And another line this side and another line this side. This way, Debye was able to give explanation to transverse normal Zeeman effect with the help of quantum mechanical treatment. This could be well understood from an example. The original line, nu naught, splits up into three components in transverse view. So the midline and the right side line, nu 1 equal to nu naught plus EB by 4 pi M naught, and the left line is nu naught minus EB by 4 pi M naught. Nu naught is the frequency of the original line, and nu 1, nu 2 are the frequencies of the lines which are on either side of the original line, and they are symmetrically distributed. Let us take L equal to 2, orbital quantum number L equal to 2, and orbital quantum number L equal to 1. ML can have 2 L plus 1 values. Now consider L equal to 1. L equal to 2, B equal to 0. So each line is single line only because B is 0. If the electron gets absorbs energy and gets excited to higher level, it returns back to the lower level by emitting out the same energy which it absorbed. So there is no change in its frequency. What it absorbed and got to the excited state comes back to the ground state by emitting the same amount of energy. So we observe a single line in the absence of the magnetic field. Now you apply the magnetic field. When you apply the magnetic field, this line splits up into 2L plus 1 values. Now you see, this line value is L equal to 1. So what is 2L plus 1? 2 into 1 plus 1. 3 levels. So the moment you apply the magnetic field, this line is splitting up into three levels. And this line, L equal to 2, substitute here, you are getting five lines. So this level, in the presence of magnetic field, splits up into five levels. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 levels. Now, if an electron absorbs energy and gets excited to the higher level, what are the possibilities? Here it has to return back to the single level only. Whereas here, excited state is 5 levels and the lower level is 3 levels. So there is a possibility. Now already I told selection rule, ML should change by 0 or plus 1 or minus 1. Now let me say the electron absorbing energy got excited to the highest level, where ML value is plus 2. This electron from this level could jump to this level. What is delta ML? 2 minus 1. So it is 1. So the change in ML could be plus 1 or minus 1 or 0. Suppose the electron has excited to this state, it can return to this state. What is its ML value? Plus 1, minus 0. So plus 1 once again. If it got excited to this level, it can return back to this level. What is ml? Change in ml. 0 minus of minus 1 plus 1. So all the three lines delta ml can have plus 1 value. Because delta ml is same, the energy ml into eb by eh by 4 pi m0 into b remains the same. Change in delta ml is plus 1. So change in energy also same. So though there are three transitions, they appear as a single line because change in energy is same for all the three lines. Same way we can explain here. If the electron is excited here and it can come to this level. Now you see plus 1 to plus 1 level. So plus 1 minus plus 1, 0. So this line delta ml equal to 0. Now find delta ml for this. 0 to 0. So 0 minus 0, 0. Now find for this line minus 1 minus of minus 1 means minus 1 plus 1, 0. So for all these three transitions, delta ml is 0 and is allowed. And the change in energy remains the same. So these three lines together forms a single line. Same way, for this set you just see, if the electron jumps from this level to this level, so 0 minus plus 1. What happens? Delta ml becomes minus 1. Now from this level to this level, so minus 1, minus 0. So minus 1 once again. From this level to this level, minus 2, minus of minus 1 becomes plus 1. So minus 2 plus 1 becomes minus 1. Delta ml value for these three transitions are minus 1. Delta ml can be 0, delta ml can be plus 1, delta ml can be minus 1. So though there are 9 transitions, we will be able to see only 3 lines in the transverse view. So beautifully, Debye gave this explanation for normal transverse Zeeman effect. In longitudinal Zeeman effect, only the midline is missing. Now, applications of Zeeman effect, we can find out the separation between the lines, which is called Zeeman shift, delta nu equal to Eb by 4 pi m0. We can find out the specific charge E by m0 using the following formula. We know frequency equal to C by lambda. So find out what is delta nu. D nu equal to, here nu is varying means lambda is varying. So when you differentiate, d nu becomes minus C by lambda square d lambda. Now, d lambda, you find out d lambda equal to lambda square by C into d nu. We have ignored the minus sign telling only the magnitude is taken into account. We know what is d nu. Substitute this value here. So lambda squared by C. Now the specific charge is E by M0. Keep E by M0 here and rearrange the formula. You will be getting the formula E by M0 equal to 4 pi C by V into D lambda by lambda squared. By substituting the value of velocity of light, the applied magnetic field and the wavelength using spectrometer, we can determine D lambda can be found out. Substituting all that, E by M0 value was found to be 1.757 into 10 power 11 coulomb per kilogram. This is very much in agreement with the value found by J.J. Thomson experiment. So that's Zeeman effect is in well agreement with the value given by J.J. Thomson experiment. The Zeeman experiment became a successful one. I hope you have understood what is Zeeman effect, what are its types, in strong magnetic field, in transverse view, how it is splitting, in longitudinal view, how it is splitting, in weak magnetic field, how the anomaly Zeeman effect is coming, and what is the quantum mechanical explanation with the energy level diagram we have understood. Thank you, one and all.